Hi, thanks for joining us today. If this ministry has impacted your life, we want to hear about it. You can send us your story at amen@vineyardchurch.com. Also, we would love if you would partner with us financially. You can go to vineyardchurch.com and click the Give Online or text your donation amount to 757-230-2110.
To honor copyright laws, we have removed some audio and video elements from this message. Now here's this week's message.
Good afternoon.
Oh, that's loud.
Might turn me down just a tad. All right. Well, I'm so glad to be with you this afternoon. This is great. Have you ever had an experience in your life that you encountered that was so impacting that it like radically shaked you and sent you in a different direction? Right? Like maybe it's when you met your future spouse, right? That unexpected meeting and stuff, and it just kind of changed the whole way your life went, that whole trajectory. It could even have been one of those, you know, tragic events that takes place and while painful, actually produced a positive directional change for you, and you're going in a way that you never thought was possible, right? Well, there was indeed for me a time when I had a life-altering, a life-changing experience, and that was when I met the Holy Spirit, okay? And so when I met him, I wasn't looking for him. I didn't expect to meet him. And indeed, I encountered him in the summer of 78, when I encountered him, it was so radical in my life that it changed the trajectory of where I went. And for 39 years, I've been following after him and been very thankful for all that he has done for me in my life and the way he has given me such purpose and meaning, and he meets me daily. Actually, the Holy Spirit is the most important relationship that I have, right? And so for the next 6 weeks, we want to take you on a journey with us to introduce you to who the Holy Spirit is. And so we're going to look at things like who he is and what he does. We're going to look at how you can encounter him and some of the gifts that he brings to us. We're going to look at how we can especially follow him in the tough seasons and how we can actually use what he's doing in our lives to be able to extend that help to other people. Right? And so with that in mind, what I want to also let you know is that we are developing some of our small groups that are coming along, and they're actually following every topic that we are going to cover for these weeks so that you have a chance to dialogue in those groups, expand on it more, and actually even almost receive prayer and begin to practice some of the things that you're hearing here. So my encouragement to you is to take time today to go and to view those small groups that are being offered. And in the cafe, they're highlighting those today, okay? All right, great. Now, my prayer for this series has been that each and every one of you would be able to walk up, you know, or to wake up each morning, each day, and go, oh, hello, Holy Spirit, and see him move in your life. Bow your heads with me, and I'm going to pray before I jump into the content. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Yeah, you're needed. And so, Holy Spirit, I ask that you would come even more. I know that you're present, but I ask really for you to ask our understanding of who you are so that we can see you very clearly, Lord. So, Holy Spirit, I ask that you come, that you would stop the distractions, Lord. Cause our mind to be focused singularly on what you have, Father. And I thank you, Lord, for this message and what you want to give to us today and share with us. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Now, today I do have the subject, Who Are You, Holy Spirit? And something the Lord prompted, believe it or not, but from the last service to this one, is to have you do something for me. On your outline that you received, I want you to pull that out. And here you go. I want you to write down one thing that you have been wanting, desiring, worried about, you know, whether it's I need direction or you have a concern about an issue in your life. And if you don't want people to read it and it's really something personal, just put initials. I want you to remember this. So just put initials there, whatever it is. If you need direction, if you need healing, put it up there. Put it up there. I feel like the Lord told me to ask you to do that this service. Okay? All right. So let me start out by telling you how the Holy Spirit has interacted with my life, right? So I'm going to tell you some of the ways that I have been involved with the Holy Spirit. The first one, I think I was first keenly aware of him when in my 20s I was having a kidney issue that was reoccurring, and I prayed and the Lord healed me in a service I was in. Right? And then right after that, even though that was huge, what was even bigger was the Lord challenged me and said, hey, I want to heal people, Sharon. That is my desire. And so he radically challenged me on that. And I thought, okay, Lord, if that's what you want, I want to be a part of it. And so I always make myself available for prayer and to jump in to pray, whether it's physical, emotional, mental, it doesn't matter, even spiritual. Okay? And I believe that God wants to heal us. He wants to take us forward. I don't think he's the author of illnesses and sicknesses and stuff, but I do see those. I acknowledge the reality of those in our midst. And so I believe that the Lord wants to grow us in our faith and how we walk this out. Okay? So here's a few things I've seen the Lord do. Like there was a woman that I worked with I think it was last year. Anyway, she came to me and she, in the prayer group I was in, and she said, after service, she said, Sharon, I have been trying to get pregnant for 8 years and I can't. They tell me I have a uterine issue. Would you please pray? And I'm like, oh yeah. So we laid our hands on her uterus and we started to pray for it. She said she felt a warmth, right? She said, I feel something warm, but you know, I don't know. And I said, well, we're going to go ahead, and Lord, I believe that you're doing a work here. And so she's a member of our church, so she was on, you know, went on her way, and so nothing seemed to happen. But we took it. I took it into my prayer closet and started praying for her and stuff. And within the next month or month and a half, whatever, she comes to tell me, I'm pregnant, you know, which is pretty cool, right? But then she goes, yeah, she gave birth to a little baby girl, healthy, healthy little girl, right? And then there was another time when a young woman who sought me out to come talk to me, she had severe depression issues. I mean, she was on medication, but it was crippling her life. And so she came to talk to me because she didn't know what she could do. And so as we were there and as we were sharing, you know, I was like, okay, because I know nothing, guys, right? It's just ordinary me. So I'm praying. I'm like, okay, Lord, what could I possibly offer to this young woman? Nothing, but you have everything to offer. And so as I have done before, come, Holy Spirit, come and show me, you know, open my mind, show me what you want to do here. And as I was praying that over this young woman, I heard very clearly the word abortion. And I thought, okay. And so I just, you know, stopped my prayer. And so I discreetly said to her, have you ever had an abortion? And she looked at me in this the floodgate of tears and said, yes. And she recounted what happened to her as a young woman, actually a young child. And so she shared that with me. And I thought, okay, the Lord wants to go after this. You know, this must be part of the depression, right? So I went back to pray again. And then I heard very clearly the Lord said, no, not abortion, abortions, plural. And I thought, oh. And so, you know, I popped up my head and I looked and I said, is there more? And she cried. She looked at me and she goes, how do you know that? I have told nobody my whole entire life. How do you know that? And I looked at her and I said, I don't know anything, baby. But I know that the Holy Spirit knows, and he knows your desire to be free from the depression, and this somehow is involved in it. So by exposing it, what he wants you to do is he wants you to be set free from the pain of that. And we did pray that day, and she did find freedom. Here you go. Yeah, it's remarkable. When you're in the process of it, you're like, whoa. So anyway, some other stories on how God works is many of you know about my difficulty with infertility and not being able to get pregnant for a long time, and then the miscarriages, right? Numerous ones in my different trimesters, how hard that was. And it was, I thought I wasn't going to be able to make it emotionally because it was so traumatic on me that all this was going on. And at that time, God really challenged me not to ask the why questions, but instead of relying on my own understanding that I was to rely not on that, but on him instead. And so he burned that down inside of me. And I did get through that period. But here you go. Here's some more remarkable thing. He deposited in me this strength to be able to help other people in the worst times that they're facing. Like, for instance, I got a call a couple of years back from a husband and wife. Their child died a couple hours after birth. And so they called, and I was able to come and to get right where they were at and to actually step in to their grief, right? But it's not just stepping into the grief to hold their hand and to cry with them, but it was to be the voice of the Holy Spirit to say, it is not as you see it right now. You know, even though there's pain right now, you need to know that every life, no matter how long it's lived, is precious before the Lord, and that one day you will be reunited, that death is but a doorway that we walk through, and each and every one of us will walk through it, and the place that we go to is to be with our Heavenly Father. Do you see that? And so you're able to bring that message into a very, very dark place. And it brings peace, peace in the heart and the mind of those that I sat with that day. And then many of you know that as my pregnancies went on, when I was able to carry a child almost to term, that child was diagnosed with a rare disease that was supposed to take his life upon him being born, right? And I can remember to this day laying on that examining table and them doing the ultrasound stuff and them all leaving the room because they all went, right? You know, that horrible feeling, right? And so when they left, I knew I was in trouble again. And I was like, Lord, but I heard the heartbeat. It's mine. And I just, you know, I was becoming unglued. And I heard the Holy Spirit whisper to me, his name will be Samuel. And I thought, whoa. So when they came in and they gave me the prognosis, Andy and I was like, no, God said his name's Samuel. Now, I didn't know what all that meant. I just knew that that was the seed that he placed inside of me. And I carried that promise and that hope with me while we nurtured Samuel in my womb. And indeed, by that last month or so, God did a miraculous healing in his life. He's in the books, in the medical books, miracle, because he was born alive. And he is a pastor here now. And you fast forward, right? This is what the Lord does. This is what our God does. And I could stop there, and that's a great story, but let me tell you what God has done, what he birthed in me, the faith that he gave me. It was the beginning of last year. I got a call from Andy, and he said, hey, Sharon, I need you to come to meet me at this dinner place to meet so-and-so. And I was like, oh, man, Andy, I got a lot going on today. He said, no, it's very important. I want you to come. So I know he doesn't do that often. It's like, sure, I'll come. I'll be there, right? And so I got there, and really what had happened was a young couple in their early 30s, she had just experienced a loss of her child. She was carrying a baby 6 months. The baby dies. And so they're distraught. So, of course, I'm like, okay, the Lord's going to have me come in and share with them and kind of love on them, right? Which we did. And I established a relationship with her. She's part of our church, the family. And so anyway, fast forward another season, and she gets pregnant again, and so we're rejoicing. And then when she found out she was having twins, I was like, oh yeah, man, that's great, right? Twin boys. And then I remember it was about 6-7 months. She comes to me, her and her husband come into one of these services, and she comes up after, and she's like white as a sheet, and she looks at me, and she said, I got the diagnosis that one of my boys has a congenital birth defect and is going to die. And so they've asked me if I want to terminate the pregnancy, you know, because there were two babies. And she just looked, she goes, I don't know what to do. Well, I didn't know what to do. My heart was broken because I loved her so and her husband. And I thought, okay, the only place I know to run is to the Lord. And I said, stop, let's stop right here. Let's start to pray. And in my heart and in my sincerity down deep, I'm like, God, come. Holy Spirit, show me how to pray. Give me the words I need in order to handle this and help walk with her and her husband. And was at that time the Lord said, I want you to pray for her faith. And then I want you to pray for his faith. I want you to breathe on their faith, Sharon. And so I laid hands on them. I prayed for her and then him. And then he goes, and then the Lord said, now I want you to lay hands on the belly. And I want you to start praying and speaking to the boys in utero. And I want you to start claiming their healing and being able to talk about this battle that's going on. And so I did that. And then the word battle stuck with me. And when I came off of praying for them, I looked them dead in the eye and I said, listen, this is a life or death fight for your children. And I want to encourage you to pray for one another and to pray daily, daily for your children that are not born yet. And let's see what the Lord does. Now, last week, I had them over to my house and their babies are healthy. They were born, two babies. I was playing with them on my carpet, right? And so I was reminded, God is in control of everything. You know, I love the medical people, but God is ultimately the physician, the healer of things. And so we need to rely into him. And he also wants to even have this daily interaction with us. The Holy Spirit wants to talk to us. He wants to define his voice. It's so important that you know this, you know, that you can recognize his voice. He has taken me over these 39 years, and he has constantly teaching me what is his voice, what is my voice, and what is other people's voice. Why? So that I might follow him and not be deceived, right? And so that's so vitally important. I remember that this process really began to be clear to me when we started this church. See, it was so hard to start this work when we first started. The finances weren't here. I mean, just we struggled and struggled. And I had a friend, Andy and I did a pastor friend in the city, and he saw us struggling, and he said, he goes, hey, just shut it down. You know, come on over here. I'll pay you. I'll do this, right? And all that other stuff. And it sounded pretty good, but then that voice deep down inside said, no, that is not me. You are not to do that. And if you just stop and look around at the work that God has done, he knew what he was doing right in the midst. I didn't understand it at the time, and it was hard, but God had a higher purpose in mind. So we, as Christ followers, need to be able to hear his voice, to define what his voice sounds like, so that we will not follow a stranger no matter how good it looks. Right? So the Holy Spirit, these stories that I'm telling you, it talks about healings, it talks about bringing comfort and bringing courage and wisdom and helping to set direction. These are all things that the Holy Spirit brings into our lives. And there are stories that each week we're going to cover a different aspect of what he does. And I want to encourage you to be a part of that. Now, unless you are tempted to think, oh, that's like abnormal stuff. That didn't really happen to us ordinary people, does it? You know, that's for the holy, the special ones. No. Look what Jesus says to his disciples. And by the way, you and I are his disciples. In John 14:17, it says, he is the Holy Spirit who leads into all truth. The world cannot receive him because it isn't looking for him and doesn't recognize him. But, now this is to you guys that are believers, listen, but you know him because he lives with you now and later will be in you, talking about the indwelling of the Holy Spirit there. We'll get to that in a moment. It is God's intent for each and every one of us to have an intimate involvement with the Holy Spirit. It's not for special people. It's for us ordinary people, right? This is something that God is done for us. So we need to know who the Holy Spirit is. And so let's talk about that. Who are you, Holy Spirit? First thing is he is the third person of the Trinity. He's the third person of the Trinity. Now, in order to tackle this, this is kind of a big one. In order to tackle this, I need you to realize that your thoughts and your views that you presently have where you're sitting here are, you know, about the Father God, about the Son Jesus Christ, and about the Holy Spirit, that those are clouded by how you were brought up and what you encountered, right? So whether you're Catholic, Pentecostal, you know, Lutheran, you're in Judaism, you know, whether you're agnostic, You know, or you come out of a pluralistic belief system, whatever. Oh, those things are all going to cloud what's going to happen here. Matter of fact, how you were raised in your family, whether your father and your mother were harsh and demanding or whether they were nurturing and loving, all that plays in and colors how you see the Father God, how you see the Son Jesus Christ, and how you interact with the Holy Spirit. So I want us to go into Scripture because I want to give you enough ammo or enough thoughts to think about what do you think and to challenge the thoughts that you might even have. Okay? So let's go to your scriptures there. First, I want to start in the book of Genesis. I'm going right back to the smack dab to the very beginning of the Bible. We're going to open it up. And what I want you to see is that when God created the earth, he said, let there be light, and there was light, right? And he created the heavens, and he created all the living creatures, and he did it just by speaking them into existence. But I want you to notice that it's different when it comes to human beings, right? In Genesis 1:26, this is what he says. God said, let us, circle that, let us make man in our image, in our likeness. Who is the us? It's God, isn't it? Who's the us he's referring to? Well, I think this is the first indication of the intrinsic nature of what makes God up. I think way back there, he wants us to understand it. And if you go and you read the scriptures in the Old and the New Testament and you're reading them, it reveals that indeed God is one in essence, but three in person. He's one in an essence and he's three in person, right? He's got three parts there. And so we have the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. They're fully God, yet they make up what God is. Okay? So I want you to look quickly with me at some scriptures for you to consider later on. Guys, this so impacts the way you interact with the Holy Spirit. First, Philippians 1:2 says, grace and peace to you from God the Father. In other words, God is called Father here. Titus 2:13, it says, while we wait for the blessed hope, the glorious appearing of our Lord, of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. Again, showing that Jesus is distinctively a God himself. And then in Acts 5:3-4, we see this when Peter says, Ananias, how is it that Satan has so filled your heart that you have lied to the Holy Spirit? What made you think of doing such a thing? You have not lied to man, but to God, indicating that the Holy Spirit is distinctively a God, that he is God himself. So what we're seeing here is the Father, right? You're seeing Jesus, the Son, and you're seeing the Holy Spirit. All three of them are talked about as being God, yet we know they're three distinctions. Are you sure they're distinctions, Sharon? Are you not sure they're just a role, one God and some role, right? The roles they play? Well, no, let's go look at these last two scriptures to show you their distinctiveness. First, John 3:16, which a lot of us are acquainted with, it says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believe in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. What you see there is this distinction between the Father who is sending the Son, so they cannot be the same. And then likewise, we see in John 14:26, where Jesus says this, but the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he's going to teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all that I have said to you. And again, it distinguishes out the personhood of the Holy Spirit being separate from the Father and from the Son. So you see this unique thing that's going on where we have one God, right? But these three unique persons that make up the God. We call that Trinity, right? The triune being is the word that we use for that. So I was thinking about how could I get this concept to you, right? Because it's so important to the Christian walk, especially in dealing with the Holy Spirit. And so let me ask you a question. How many of you have eaten eggs? Raise your hand. Come on, come on, come on, come on. Yes? Okay. How many of you have cooked eggs? Ha, less, but still, right? All right. So here's an egg. Here's an egg, just an ordinary egg. It has three parts, doesn't it? It has a shell, it has the egg white, and then the yolk. And the three parts are what make up the egg. All three make one, yet all three are distinct, are they not? Yes, that's what its Trinity is like, okay? I'm trying to make it real simple for you guys there. So hopefully you got that idea. Now, you've learned that the first Think about who the Holy Spirit is. He is the third part of the Trinity. The second thing I want to show you about who the Holy Spirit is, he is the proclaimer and the revealer of the good news. He is the proclaimer and the revealer of the good news. His job is to tell us how much God loves us. And the Holy Spirit makes sure that you and I know that he loves us, God loves us so much, but that we have fallen short of the glory of God, right? That sin has separated us. And so the job of the Holy Spirit is to always be moving upon all of mankind to work in them so that they would begin to realize that the only way to be able to rectify this distance that we have is to accept the Son, Jesus Christ, and what he did on the cross for us in taking. He was our substitution for our sins. So when we begin to understand that, and the Holy Spirit, he brings in his wisdom, he brings that stuff around and he uniquely presents it to people so that they get it, right? That's all the Holy Spirit's doing, all that, right? And then he's wooing us like a lover. He's always calling to us to do what? To come back to the home where the loving Father is. And that's one of the things that the Holy Spirit does. And he does it uniquely in each one of our lives. I can go back to when he wooed me, right? Back in 1978, the Lord began to woo me back then. I just finished high school, and I know I just dated myself. But I finished high school, and I had been dating a young man for 2 years. Was crazy about him. He was my whole world, right? So I get out of high school. I go to work at one of those little beach shops. And I'm thinking, I'm going to marry this guy. We're good. It's all good. And then that summer really did not turn out the way I thought. He decided, the young man I was dating, that he decided that he would rather have another woman, right? Now, I can't tell you the emotional distraughtness that brought this 18-year-old girl, right? I thought my whole world had ended. It was tough. I was depressed. I was upset. I felt bad. And so I was moping around, and I wasn't seeking the truth. I was just living my life. And then all of a sudden, when this hits, my mom, who was a Christ follower, she got saved in Billy Graham Crusade, right? She takes the opportunity to share with me the difference that having a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, what that can do for you. And I thought, interesting, because I grew up a Catholic, so I knew about God. I knew about Jesus. I knew up here, but I did not know down here. I did not know that he could help me, and he wanted a personal relationship with me. I didn't know that. And so you better believe I jumped at the chance to have what I heard and what I had seen in her life up to that point. So she prayed with me, and I gave my heart to Christ that day. And then she invited me to church, and I jumped on it. I went to church to try to figure out, what does this mean, right? Because I was so, what does this mean? God, teach me, show me. So anyway, in that process and going to church, I began to discover things about myself and about who God was and who I was. And the whole time, the Holy Spirit's working on me. Well, towards the end of that summer, this young man that I was so crazy about, right, he shows back up. And he starts talking to me, and he shows up with a ring, and he asks me to marry him. Now, you would think, right? You would think it'd be like, yeah, God, you took care of that one, right? Good, slam dunk. You would think that, but that's not what happened. All of a sudden, I looked, everything I thought I wanted, inside I had to step back, and I looked at him, I said, I love you too. I love you, and I forgive you, and I ask you to forgive me for where I've hurt you. But I cannot marry you. And it's not because there's somebody else. There's a dream of something that's gone inside of me. And I don't know what it is, but I know it's not about marrying you anymore. And I walked away. Now, how can that happen? How can you do that? Well, in 2 Corinthians 5:17, it says this. This means that anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person. The old life is gone and the new person has begun. So that's that Holy Spirit bringing you into this new life, right? You know, he nudges us, the Holy Spirit nudges us to take that step, to trust Jesus, to ask him into our lives. And when we do that, he does this radical new thing. He births in us and we're a new person. And that's, you know what else I found out, right? Is that not only are we birthed into being a new person, but he actually then starts to indwell us. Look what it says here in Luke 17, 21. He says, for indeed, the kingdom of God is within you. It's within you. So there's this kingdom of God. He puts his Holy Spirit in us, so then now it's dwelling inside of us, right? That's how I could say, no, I don't want to do that. I didn't have enough strength to do that. But I could do it because the Holy Spirit resides inside of me, and I was a new person, and I had the ability to walk away from things I thought. Now, I know you're thinking, the Holy Spirit can indwell you. You know, I'm pretty messed up. So was I, right? Did I have a lot of issues? Yes. A lot of problems? Yes. Was I instantly been able to follow everything? No. But that didn't predicate the Holy Spirit inviting himself to be a part of my life, because his ability to indwell us has nothing to do about our righteousness, about our behavior. It has everything to do about what Jesus Christ did and his power that he now wants to put inside of us to transform us. Look what it says in John 3:5-8. Jesus said, "Truly, truly, I say unto you, unless one is born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of flesh is flesh, and that which is born of spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I say to you, you must be born again. The wind blows where it wishes, and you can hear its sound, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit." In other words, there's this marvelous mystery that takes place when the Holy Spirit comes upon us and comes inside of us. And a lot of times it takes a long time to recognize that he actually is indwelling us once we find the Christ. Yeah. Okay. So I also know that there are some of you in here today, and the Holy Spirit is nudging you because you don't have the personal relationship that he knows that you need to have with a holy God. And so he's nudging you to come home. He's nudging you to put Jesus Christ first and to ask him for his salvation that he offers you. And at the end of my time with you today in this service, I'll give you the opportunity to pray. But it's the Holy Spirit that brought you here, that you matter to him, and he's been wooing you. And today's the day of salvation for you. Okay? All right. So now we've learned the Holy Spirit, he is the proclaimer and the revealer of the good news. He is the third part of the Trinity we talked about. And lastly, who is the Holy Spirit? He is the heart tenderizer. He is the heart tenderizer. Now, I'm like a practitioner. I'm just like so plain Jane and ordinary, right? So I was thinking, well, Lord, how am I going to get this across? Ha! My meat tenderizer. Okay? I'm going to make it so stinking practical that you cannot say you walk out here, I did not know what you was talking about. Okay? All right. Meat tenderizer. The way this thing works is you take the meat tenderizer, you take a piece of meat, and you shake it on there, right? You shake it on the meat, and what it does is it gets into the meat, and it breaks down the sinew, and it, you know, softens it up. So when you throw it on the grill, right, or you throw it on whatever, then what happens is the original flavor of the meat begins to come out, right? And you can enjoy it. Well, I believe that this is how the Holy Spirit works in our lives, right? That he is our meat tenderizer. He's our heart tenderizer. And so he shakes himself over our heart to tenderize, to make it soft and pliable. And what happens is when we accept the Lord Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit indwells in us, the thing I talked to you about earlier, if you can remember in Genesis, I said that you were made in whose image? God's image. Good, you're paying attention. In God's image, right? And so what happens is when sin enters in our lives, that image that was a God image that was born inside of us, we were all created that way, it's gone dormant. And so when I invite the Holy Spirit's presence inside, right, and accept Christ, what happens is it starts to come alive because of the tenderization that comes up. And all of a sudden, the attributes of who I am as a child of the God Most High starts to come into being. Right? Do you see that? It starts to come up. And so we start to learn who we are as what Christ says about us. And it's this journey that we begin. And Ezekiel 36:26-27 refers to it. "And I will give you a new heart, put a new spirit in you, and I will take out your stony, stubborn heart and give you a tender, responsive heart, and I will put my spirit in you." And so it's talking about what the Holy Spirit does to us inside, how he makes us more responsive to the Heavenly Father, right? All work of the Holy Spirit here, all this work. So Meat tenderizing, very important in growth, but here you go. This meat tenderizer, I learned something new. It was a while back. I like to scuba dive, or I did when I was younger, right? And so one of the dive masters, one time when I was scuba diving, he had this in his bag, and I thought, well, that's a dumb thing to put in your bag, right? I wonder why he's done that. Maybe he's going barbecuing later. I don't know. So anyway, I picked it up. I said, why do you have the meat tenderizer in your bag? And he goes, oh, because, you know, sometimes when we go out here and the jellyfish will sting me or a sea creature will get on me and he injects the poison. He goes, if I come right up and I put meat tenderizer on, it's got something in the reaction that will take out the poison. I thought, oh my gosh. If that's not a spiritual analogy, I don't know what is, right? So I got to thinking, I thought, I want to tell them that. Because here you go, I believe that Jesus Christ gave us the Holy Spirit to be our meat tenderizer, right? To tenderize our heart. And so when you and I, we go through life, you and I, we do life. And in life, what happens? We get stung. We get hurt. And a lot of times, poison will be injected into us by different things. Like what? Could be like, you know, maybe a marriage, right? A relationship that has hurt you or wounded you or has failed you, right? It could be your relationship with your parents and what they injected in you, and you have this, you know, a warped view or pain inside, and you walk around with pain. I mean, and it could be choices that you made and you knew you weren't supposed to do. And you knew you weren't supposed to walk in that, and yet you walked in it. And so the poison is there, and it's part of your life. And you're like, what am I going to do? The tenderizer, the Holy Spirit, that's what you're going to apply in your life. Well, how does this work in practical terms, Sharon? The way it works is that the place that you feel the pain, the place that you feel the poison at, the entry place, whatever it is, I'm going to advocate that you go right back up and that you sit before the Heavenly Father, you invite the Holy Spirit, and you start to talk about it. You start to talk about what has happened, what event went on that has caused you such turmoil in your life. And as you're sitting there, the Holy Spirit's going to work with you, and you will, he'll ask you this question: what was your part to play? And we all have it. I don't care what it is that you, there is a part that you played in this stuff. And so it's at that time he'll ask you to confess your part, you know, to share with him your part. And then he'll even challenge you. He'll even challenge you to forgive the people that hurt you. And I know that's so hard to do, but he'll challenge you there because he has a different perspective than you and I do on forgiveness. And so he'll challenge you to forgive. And I tell you, if you allow yourself to walk through this process with him, what happens is that the Holy Spirit's there and he starts to draw out the poison. He starts to pull it out. What you could not do yourself, the Holy Spirit will do for you. See, that's the power that he offers us. And it doesn't stop right there. You know, when I find that I have been deeply wounded about something and or I have that poison in my life, I go through that process that I described to you. And then right behind that, I find what God's word has to say about that issue, about that thing. And then I start talking to the Lord and I ask the Holy Spirit, now, Holy Spirit, come and tenderize my heart that I might, you know, see as you do about this issue, whatever it is. And so I start to use his word to transform my mind and my behaviors, right? And then I invite the body of Christ, I invite Christ's followers to walk beside me. Why? Because I need somebody to talk to, yes. But more importantly, I need them to pray with me and to encourage me not to give up and to hold me accountable that I would continue to walk out what the Lord is trying to do in my life. That's why we're so big on small groups here. We want you guys to be able to find this freedom I'm talking about. And it's all here for you. The Holy Spirit is here to help you live successfully. Now, the Apostle Paul, in the book of Philippians, he tells his disciples this, Philippians 2, 12 and 13. Therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, right? I want you to work out your own salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God who works in you both to will and to work for his good pleasure. And now you read that, you know that we don't work for our salvation, that it's a gift that's given by Jesus Christ. So what is he talking about here? He is talking about the work, the hard work, taking it serious of allowing the Holy Spirit to work in us, to allow him to tenderize us, allow him to extract the poison that we have in our life. That's the hard work he's talking about. That's our part. That's our responsibility to do. So today you have learned about the Holy Spirit. You have learned who he is he is a third part of the Trinity. He is the proclaimer and the revealer of the good news, and he is your heart tenderizer. And it is my prayer that as you take these concepts and you begin to pray for them, especially, remember I told you to write down that thing that bothered you, that you had issues with on your paper? He wants to talk to you today about that. He doesn't want you to go out of here without dealing with that issue or that thing, right, that's on your paper. He wants you to apply the tenderizer because he wants to do a radical thing in your life. But the Holy Spirit will never make you. He will woo you like a lover to deal with it. And it's my heart that you would be able to do what I do, which is to call upon, Lord, Holy Spirit, manifest, show me where you are so I can move according. And in that, every morning I can say, hello, Holy Spirit. Bow your heads with me. Thank you, Father. Yes, Lord. Holy Spirit, I thank you for your presence and your activeness in this room. And so, Father, I ask that the gift of the Holy Spirit which you have given us, that you would teach us over the next weeks, Lord, that we would become a people that could hear your voice and that we could move in the power of the Holy Spirit that you have given us. Yes, Lord. Increase their faith, Father. Increase them. Increase it. I hear that. Now, there's some of you, you don't have this personal relationship with Jesus Christ. And before I can even go on, as all the heads are bowed, I want to talk to you right now. I want to invite you to respond to the Holy Spirit that's been prodding you the whole time I've been sharing today. And so if you want to ask Jesus Christ into your life so that you can start this personal relationship right where you're at right now, you just say, Father God. Go ahead, just say, Father God, I don't understand it all, but I accept your Son, Jesus Christ. I ask for your forgiveness. And Jesus, I ask you to be the leader of my life. Okay, there you go. Okay. That simple, but that profound. I'm going to pray for those that pray that prayer. Father, seal it in their heart. I thank you that you wrote their name in the book of life, and we look to you, the one true God, to be able to come and to show us the triune being that you are, Lord Jesus. And Father, you have stirred in our hearts, Lord, and you've made it practical about those things on our paper that we wrote. And I ask, Lord, as we enter back into worship, that you would bring it up and you would embolden people to deal with it today, to deal with it today and not to take it with them. I thank you in Jesus' name, amen.
Thanks for listening to this week's message. We hope you enjoyed it. Don't hesitate to write us your story at amen@vineyardchurch.com. And we'll see you next week.